one last talk with two speakers before we get to go for lunch, but stick around because it's going to be very interesting. I welcome on stage, getting ready, Maurizio Garzelli from APIda and Ingolf Rauh. Did I pronounce your name correctly? How? from Swisscom. And they are going to tell us how electronic signatures and APIs can make customer onboarding more easy. So a warm welcome, please.
Thank you very much for being here. So this topic is about leveraging ADAS that you have heard about, two PSPs to sign and legally bind documents in an easy way. So without further ado, let's go to the next one. So first of all, who are we? We are APIda. We are a company that provides services and our resellers, the one reseller for CA Broadcom for the API management suite. We also provide solutions for different markets, including banking, and we have partnered with Swisscom in order to provide a quick and easy way to a quick and easy way to onboard customers and onboard So what are the problems with customer onboarding at the moment? So many traditional banks require that their customers come in with certain papers that show who they are, and certain checks have been made and so on. This is quite a manual way. There are already banks out there, for example, N26, online banks, that skip all that. And they just, you know, you ask for something, you don't need to go anywhere, and you just get your card. I also Revolut, which is another one of these banks. And our goal is to provide traditional banks with the same facility in a quick and easy way, because we know that traditional banks are traditionally much bigger. They have been around the block quite a lot of times, and it's hard for them to change, especially to adopt inside their own system this kind of electronic signature and way of thinking. So what do we provide? We provide this system of the signature, which means that the documents that the digital documents that the bank will receive will be verified and will be signed by an ADAS. This will entice is to make the use of existing verified entities. So the ADAS entities, and leveraging these through trusted APIs. Trusted APIs meaning companies like Swisscom who already have APIs that are trusted, that will provide you the signature you want. We provide that bridge that stops this gap.
Yeah, now probably I can step in here. So Swisscom is the only European-based service provider with remote signatures which are compliant to EIDAS and compliant to Switzerland. And you know, Switzerland is always the island in the EU. And if we have a look to what is necessary really to onboard customers in a lot of countries, especially in Middle Europe, you need a qualified electronic signature also to sign. And, for this, we have to have a look to the EIDAS regulation, particularly Article 24, which outlines what is necessary. And first, we know all, it's the physical presence of a natural person, which is not very favorable if you're doing things electronically. Or probably remotely, how it's called here in the legal language, using electronic identification means for which a physical presence of an actual person was assured. So this means nothing else than video identification. And of course, then we have also other identification methods which are recognized on national level. So we are registered as qualified trust service provider in Austria with our subsidiary in Austria, and we are also registered in Switzerland. And in Austria, we have then the possibility also to use for whole Europe a bank-based identification. I will just show you in a minute how this works. If we go through all the identification methods which are possible, physical presence means very often for most of us going to the post office. Now this was a classical way, we go to the post office or anywhere else, whether it's a point of sale, which are our ID card or passport or whatever else, and then we are identified. And but this is always a break, a media disruption from a lot electronic process to a paper-based process. Video identification is a little bit better, so it's a 10 minutes run, which could be done electronically based on a good camera. Okay, nowadays it's mostly the fact for 5 years ago, and based on sufficient bandwidth. So seeing the situation sometimes in Germany, it's really difficult to have this bandwidth only in big cities. Here in London it's probably not the problem. The matter of fact is that 70% of those video identifications are interrupted or will not end up with a result. And of course the process is still a manual process with a higher cost. A very promising thing is of course the EID part. The EID is also regulated or mandated by the EIDAS regulation, and a lot of European countries introduced it, so it's now part of the passport, the ID card. But okay, this would probably be the future in 2, 3, 4 years if the IDs are more and more spread. But I think a very interesting thing is the bank identification, because the bank is trusted. If you have the chance to show to a qualified trust service provider that you are identified by a bank, log in at a bank, then we could use this also for qualified signature. And a banking login is familiar to all of us. We know it's probably the PIN we all know, or the authentication method we all know. And the bank identification is very regulated. You know, it's a good fact that it must be compliant to the Money Laundering Act. And knows the customer very well. And with APIda, we have put this together in a vision. Probably you could outline this.
So in order to do so, we realize, I mean, we are resellers of the API gate. We realize that many other customers don't have that in the need. So what we provide at this point is what we would like to provide in our vision is to give this opportunity to banks to adopt this digital signature system. So we are partnering. What we have here in this digital ecosystem is a way where we, you know, the banks would have some systems a bit like DigiSign or Scribble, and they need to find a way to bridge the gap with the likes of Swisscom in order to have this digital signature system going on. And that is where the major pain point is, that this, who does the bridging of the gap? Because Swisscom has got their APIs, they work very well, and there are many ways of doing digital signatures at the client level. and you want to bridge that. And that is what we provide, is a way of bridging this gap. And so either by the bank calling an API within our ecosystem, within an ecosystem of APIda, and then that ecosystem of APIda will call Swisscom so that it can sign, or we do something on site, whether it is by using some professional services and some tailoring of web services that you already have, so that this relationship is established. It is a relationship that the bank trusts, and then you have, as a bank or as a financial institution, or even as an HR legal department, the possibility of streamlining your flow and being able to onboard people, customers, much easier and much more secure, and with the confidence that it is actually legally sound.
And such a flow, I want just to show an example. It's an example of Klarna Bank, you know, probably Klarna Bank from Sweden. It's also a payment provider in Europe. I think it's a little bit the PayPal of Europe, you could say. And so they issue credit cards via an app. So what you see here is not a mock-up, it's just all the screens from this app, because I do not want to order a credit card every time I'm presenting it. So the idea beyond the credit card is the following one. Yeah? So in earlier times, you have bought a TV or something else for £4,000. Yeah? And you came to the cash and said, oh, I cannot pay it. And normally, there was a nice guy who said, yeah, come with me to the next room, and then we will sign some credit in mortgage, interest rate of 12% or something else, and you can pay it within 6 months. So here with the Klarna card, you will pay it directly. And in the same minute you will get in the app the question, do you want to pay it now? Do you want to pay it in 3 months or in 6 months? Okay, or of course with the interest rates. But they will flow to Klarna probably, not to the shop anymore, to any bank anymore. So they want to send out these cards, and to order these cards in Germany or Austria, so you need a qualified electronic signature. But first, unfortunately this is in German now, but it's a translation of the summary is on the left-hand side. So first you said, okay, I want the card, then you select the design, probably you enter the address, and now you will find here, I have read the T's and C's from Klarna Bank and the Swisscom IT Services Finance System. From the qualified trust service provider, because you have to, it's a small print, you have to sign the T's and C's, otherwise you could not do the signature. Also, this is part of the IDAS regulation. So of course, say click, I have read it. And now they ask you for your bank institute, your favorite bank institute, your favorite bank account. And you say probably, okay, I'm account holder of Deutsche Bank. And now you have to enter your account number, and you have to enter your online banking PIN. And now something happens which is not necessary for the qualified electronic signature, but what is necessary for the anti-money laundering, they will do a transfer of 10 cents forward and back. It's also only necessary in Germany. I think it's even not normally used in the U.S. So nevertheless, you are now identified successfully by the bank. So this is, the bank says you're identified. In the background, some PC2 calls are running, or up to now even screen scraping is in use, but also some databases are requested, so that we have the results that this is a qualified, identified person. Now we will sign the contract to issue this card. And for this, we need a declaration of will. In this case, we send out here a one-time password via SMS. The one-time password will be entered. And then the contract is signed. It's done. It's open. So it's a 2 minute experience compared to the whole stuff of video identification, going to a point of sales, going to a post office, or anything else. To allow this and to open the bank identification, or generally an IDP identification, IDP authentication to us, the IDIS protocol asks for a so-called sole control of the signing certificate. It's called two, sole control two of the signing certificate. And this is provided by an OAuth2 protocol we have implemented here. There are three parties which are involved. There's some probably insurance company or some bank who wants to have a signature app. And they will first ask the IDP, you have seen in the case before, Toscana, no? could you identify this person? And the IDP says, yes, of course, I can confirm that John Doe is John Doe. And they will give an access token. And then the signature request with a hash of the document is sent out to a qualified service provider, in this case us, Swisscom, with this access token. And Swisscom will analyze this access token. They will see that which IDP is behind this access token. And then they will use the introspection call, which is also part of the OAuth2 protocol, to download the whole signature identity data for storage, because a trust service provider must store the necessary identification information 10, 20, or 30 years. So in Austria, it's 35 years where we are registered. And based on this, we will put in one-shot signature certificate into the hash, so we will return a signed hash to the signature hash. So this is what's behind. What is then used by APIDA in its gateway, and then used also for the bank to profit from the whole signature process. Yeah, some questions.
Just to let you know, the example we gave is about banking, but of course, as you saw in one of the previous slides, it's not just about banking. And I mean, of course, we are here for PSD2 and banking and open banking, so of course, this was tailored more towards a banking environment. But this can be actually applied and would be applied also for legal purposes themselves. So whenever you have a requirement where you want to electronically sign a document so that you are sure that the integrity is not only guaranteed, but it's legally guaranteed at a European level, so that nobody can ever come back to you and say, you know, hey, what you have given me is false, then you know that you are completely sure that what you have given to the third party is actually the truth, and there is only one single point of truth, which is signed and legally binding. So I think this is the main reason, is to be able to, in a way, guarantee or give the guarantee to the other party, to whoever is going to be the end customer for that document, who's going to use that document, you can guarantee to them that the document follows the directives. If then, of course, the document includes fictional data or not non-relevant, but false data, then you can guarantee to them that until your point, everything was fine. So you also, it's not about, like, you know, throwing the responsibility to somebody else, but at least in this, like, digitalized world, and in a world of delegation, because there is so much delegation going on, it's really hard. If you're the end customer and you receive something, it's really hard to backtrack and go and look where has it gone wrong. So with this, you are able to say, well, you know, I don't have to worry about this part, this step, because it's been guaranteed at the European level. So I can go further back and see where the problem occurred, which could be something legal, but it could be just a simple fault. So without pointing fingers or without saying, no, it's not me, it's them, but at least being able to guarantee a certain quality of data.
Thank you so much.